in touch with Katie since you're out there. Your year as school board chair has been a busy and productive one for our school system. Some of the notable achievements of the past year include the following. The building committee, which you are a member, was established and has seen to lend a concept design to the middle school Concord complex. We have seen test scores on the NEAs and SATs continue to improve. We have continued to foster a friendly and cooperative relationship with town council, which resulted in smooth budget process this spring. We established the diversity committee, which has begun to examine ways to enhance the climate of respect in our school. And I know this one's close to your heart. We've begun to make progress in revamping the computer curriculum. We thank you for your strong commitment to education and to the children of Cape Elizabeth, and for your willingness to give so generously of your time and talent. And in recognition of your service as board chair, I have just a few very brief comments to make before we start. We have a long agenda. I'm very honored and excited to be serving as board chair this year, and I've alluded to a few of the accomplishments that have happened in the past year, and I'd like to build on those. Among the critical issues we're facing, all of us here are aware of our desperate need for new and renovated space at the middle school and Concord. And we will all need to work together to make sure that all Cape residents understand that need and their responsibility to pass the building referendum in November. This summer, we will begin training board members, administrators, teachers, and others to use the concepts of total quality management to help us in grappling with curriculum, budgetary, and operating issues facing our school. I am confident that this training will help all of us work together within a positive framework and in the spirit of continuous improvement. There is another area where the schools must look to the community to share leadership. Recent revelations of drug use and concerns about disrespect and intolerance among our students are not just problems for the schools to deal with. The schools must provide a safe environment where genuine learning can take place, but parents must take responsibility for instilling values in their children. We will continue to provide a forum and facilitate community discussion of these issues, and above all, keep the lines of communication between school and home open. In closing, I would just like to say that I'm looking forward to working with all of you. I think this is going to be a very exciting year, and I think we're going to be comfortable. Any other adjustments to the agenda? Move on to approval of school board minutes for the meeting of May 11th, 1993. Item is comments by the high school and middle school representative.
Unfortunately, this will be my last school board meeting as a high school student. I'm graduating this Friday. My partner, graduation we'll have new speakers instead of the Sally Martin speakers. Those were chosen by the senior class of the board. That's exciting. The new school board representative next year will be Matt Wright. Another thing that's happened is that the selection and students are absolutely thrilled about your choice. Very lucky and very proud, and I'll be excited to see the changes in the school next year. As far as that goes, pretty much. Stresses out and ready for summer. So I have to say that I've been trying to get out of the way. So, thank you.
Also, as a parent who participates in the exit part of the student conference, I think it's important to be very involved in the
I included in your packet the number. I'll start with pleased to note that Mary Ellen Tracy, on her own behalf as well as on behalf of our foreign language teachers at the middle school, has been awarded a grant that is for the purpose of, actually its actual formal title is the 8th grade assessment for high school placement of foreign language students. This is a grant coming to us through the Southern Maine Partnership. And I just want to note that in the past we also have had a number of our teachers receiving grants through that vehicle, and we really are very pleased and proud to have that tradition continue this year with the 8th grade placement of foreign language students. I think this is an interesting project because it is coming about due to the efforts of our foreign language class program, which really gets youngsters into that stream early enough so that we're now moving them up through the grades to the point where we have to assess where we are, how they will build on the strengths, early strengths. And I know that on our agenda this evening we have a middle school national Spanish exam report, which I'm looking forward to hearing, just to give you again another flavor of that. I also included in your packet of communications a number of letters. I've actually had two or three others come in from other parents, and I just want to know for the record that we really appreciate parents taking the time to write a letter at the end of the school year, thanking individual teachers, sometimes groups of teachers, for projects and things that are actually going through the needs of individual teacher efforts. And I'm very happy to be able to share those letters with the members of the school board. And the final item in your communication packet is a summary, the first annual report from our director of school volunteer services, Dale Schmader. She did a report a couple of months ago, and this is a summary for those of you who are new on the board, and which you won't have to know. So I guess I'm not sure if everybody just realized we haven't that barrier we're sworn in last night. So this is the first program on the board itself. It's too long for us to read or summarize here. I think it's an impressive list of things that have been accomplished, and I just want to remind people that this was the first year that we had a volunteer director. We've changed that title somewhat, but it's Director of School Volunteer Services. Very part-time position, and Gail has certainly given it far more attention than actually the hours originally sketched out for that. We look forward to building on this, and I also just want to note that Gail was a mover and shaker in trying to help set up the senior project that we have tonight for Mindy Hall. And I also want to put a plug in for the senior project. I haven't had the pleasure of seeing some of the final exhibits and results, but I have become a very big supporter and believer of the importance of community service, so hoping to have an opportunity perhaps that I do out here in the places and I do so. Is that good?
I guess I want to put it in the I want to thank all my board members who helped us in here and did things that the last thing sometimes. I mean, I just feel a lot of things that I really want to express my thank you for the very fruitful relationship and the work of a wonderful experience for me to share.
Boards are made up totally throughout the United States of people like yourself, we'd be in no trouble. our first item under my report, and most of these reports are going to be made by somebody else, which shows you I'm a good superintendent, but I think it'll be middle school national Spanish exams. I'm not sure which one of our Sardana or one of our Spanish teachers is here tonight to explain. We just received the summary sheet on that. Sue, it's all yours.
Good evening. For those of you that do not know me, I'm Susan Dana, and I'm a Spanish teacher at Greendale Middle School. It's with pleasure that I come before you tonight to share the results of the 1993 National Spanish Exam taken by 18 of our 8th grade Spanish students. I will briefly describe the exam, and then I will inform you of the outstanding The National Spanish Exam is an academic competition sponsored by the American Association of Teachers of Spanish and Portuguese, or the AATSP. This exam is given in March of each school year all around the United States, and any student whose teacher is a member of the AATSP is eligible to participate. Generally, schools select only their top students to compete, so those who take this exam are competing against other very capable Spanish students. The exam is comprised of 8 questions, 30 oral comprehension, and 50 reading. A mean score of 40 correct, by 50%, is the goal of the AATSP. It is a very rigorous exam because it must finally distinguish the various levels of language acquisition, thereby enabling the AATSP to award significant prizes to the highest scores. Now for the good news. 18 of our 8th grade students were selected to take the level 1 exam, and 17 of them placed in the top 15 of the state of Maine. If 2 or more students receive the same score, then they share the state rank, so in some cases there are 3 or 4 students that might be in the 2nd place, or the 1st grade. I would like to share with you the state rankings, which are as follows, and I know all the school board members are here for the conferences. For the sake of time, I will not read the students that are from their other schools, those are quite here. First in the state is Kristen Knight. Second in the state is shared actually 4 ways, but 3 of the students are from Cape Middle School, Anna Parker, Elizabeth Lincoln, and Heidi Carrier. Third place, Stephen Follicard and Lynn Hennessy. Fourth place, Lee Rouser and Ann Ornatek. Fifth place, John Milligan and Andy Johnson. Ninth place, Megan Cunningham, Abigail Palin, and Rosie Williams. 11th place in the state, Sarah Nemitz. 12th place, Caroline Newcomb. 13th place, Christopher Ellis. And 15th place, Colleen Linden. All students who took this exam will be recognized on June 24th during the 8th grade awards ceremony. I would like to remind you that last year, 27th grade students took the level 1 Spanish exam, and 14 of them scored in the top 15 of the state. I've attached that to your packet here. I don't want to go through the census was presented last year. I'd be happy to answer any questions. They are part of this year's 8th grade class, and since they took the level 1 exam last year, they could not take the exam again this year. So this current 8th grade class has a total of 31 students who receive state rankings and awards in Spanish, by far the largest number in the state of Maine. These results are exciting and very heartening because this 8th grade class comprises the first wave of PLUS students who started their language study in 4th grade. I think these outstanding results are concrete evidence that our PLUS program is a success. As a professional and as a paid parent, it will be exciting to follow the progress of these PLUS students as they enter 9th grade next fall and throughout their subsequent years at Cape High School. Thank you. If you have any questions about this, I'd be happy to answer any questions or any comments. If not, I will go on to the next results.
Just a commentary. I just want to congratulate you on an outstanding performance in both Spanish and the overall program. Students have been wildly successful in the time of budget crisis and large of the program. This program has been such an enormous success for all of you who have.
Thank you. I would also like to remind you that this is actually a team effort, so it's not just me. There's also Barbara Pinnell. Actually, all of the students have Barbara Pinnell in 4th grade. And then from 6th grade, 7th grade, 8th grade, they had either Barbara Pinnell, Kathleen, or Barbara Pinnell. So it's really, it's a team effort. So I'm just here as a spokesperson. Actually, last year what we did is we did give a copy of this national exam to the entire 2nd grade class, just for our own placement purposes, assessment purposes. We have not had time to sit down and know that they have been given the assessment of these 8th grade students going to high school. But it would be nice to have all our students take the exam, but for budgetary reasons, it's $1.50 per student to take the exam, so our budget would be $150 for all 4 members. And generally, that's how it's done all across the country, because every school is going to have it. So you generally select the top students to take this exam. But I think it is a good exam for the assessment group. We just didn't get on the visiting this year with the conference. The results, the national results, again, I believe in September of 1991, we published it in the professional publication of the AATSP. I left. And even our students who did not place last year still were above the national. So, in general, have done very well on the state.
I would just like to encourage you wasn't aware that a cost consideration was going on. I know sometimes this happens, people gave down the request before it comes through because the funds are usable. Assessment is so critical, and your program is so good, that at $1.50 a student will support that. If that's something you want to do.
I think we want to, because I think that there are students that we did not select who will place for us.
That's the first I realized that you were wrestling with that issue. I just want to say that that's the kind of thing, and anybody else, staff member is dealing with that kind of thing. We are always interested in good assessment. I mean, if you thought it was a forecast or for whatever reason, something that you did because you had to do it in order to get the feedback from some state group or something, that'd be one thing. But since you see it as a good assessment of where they are and how this program is helping, even those who might not place high enough to be competitive, I think for that is good information.
Also, just very quickly, the French students, this year the eighth grade there, I believe there are five eighth grade French students who took the exam. These French students are not plus students. They're in the traditional French 1 program. In other words, they started French last year in seventh grade, or so next year they will be entering French 2 in high school. But of those five students selected to take the French exam this year, Noel Milliard placed third in Maine, and Brenna Fowler was in the top 10%. And that's that exam.
I wish I had that program when I was the next item, also on assessment, is the fourth grade assessment scores. I believe Lyle Kramer is here to comment on those. Obviously, these are the ongoing sagas of the MEAs. Every board member has a copy of your report, Lyle, in your packet, as well as a copy of the MEAs themselves. I just want, again, to take this opportunity to publicly note that scores that in the 2 years that I've been here, that people have had occasion to look at and wonder about, and that the reading and writing scores have notably improved. And I know that there's been a lot of effort at the fourth grade level, particularly in the language arts program, to organize our instruction so that that somewhat puzzling dilemma of what appeared to be a slide could be addressed. And I certainly want to thank everybody involved in that effort. I know it's the end of the year. I didn't mean that literally. Giving up the reins back to the camera. That's true, I do want to be heard. Everyone.
And
writing score for Carol Cruz. I don't remember.
It was certainly not, but I don't remember.
I would have to go back to the text. Yeah, I know. They're both quite close to what the state score is saying. I did have a report that I promised you in the summer. I told you in the summer that you can walk this first day for the schools to do it. So I'll carry back in July and August.
Yeah, I just, while on that report that's coming this summer, are we comparing the same students taking the test for the support and using the same set?
You already have the question of the set. What I've done is actually the past people here was to pull out students this way. And sometimes it takes a long time to pull out each student's score, find the differences. And then present them to the students.
I do want to say that I do agree with you that I do think this is something that's important. Why did we have those standard deviations for all the only 39 points by the state of writing performance?
I just want to reinforce that, and as Lyle pointed out, those numbers statistically, that is not a sample. That's not just a group of kids that came and had a funny group of genetic material, and so they had a skewed test results. And I do remember actually that there has, because I commented on it before, the boys' gap has been there more than just this year, although certainly not as threatening as this one. As you mentioned, we saw it significantly in the eighth grade scores too. And at that meeting, we also asked if he wanted to address it and brought that to the board. Now, I would like to ask that we have it formally addressed. Certainly, it's difficult. We can't afford to do social science studies that have been done in addressing the gender gap for girls and women in math and science. But I think we do need to make some effort at both. What we might guess, and probably just going to do that next week, guess as to what's causing this, and what we can do for this coming year, not for 2 or 3 years, but for this coming year to try to address that. For these boys who are at risk, they're going through the writing phase.
Typically, beginning reading and writing, you have a heavier population of boys and a physical condition. I would think that would be a factor that you could pull out, that you pointed out at the beginning, you know, when you came to the to look at that as a sub-issue. I realize it's certainly too much. It's going to be a lot of different dependencies.
I would like to compliment both the staff and the students and the parents for the effort that went into the past year to raise the level of abilities in the particular grade, both the third grade class, as well as great concern over a year ago, actually 2 years ago, sorry, not 2 years ago, to see them pull scores up. So it was a great commitment both by staff, students, and parents.
I would agree with what you say, Charlie, but I also am still alarmed that this is a class that I've been talking about consistently. I know a lot of kids in this class, and I think, you know, just on a very unscientific basis, there are a lot of boys in that class in particular who parents perceive as having weaknesses in those areas. So the more we can do to help these kids get up to speed as they get into next year.
Moving on to high school principal search committee, and I would ask the chair if you have some comments to listen.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank all the people that participated on the committee. We have representatives of the parents, representatives of the students, the teachers, several administrators, said than that, but if you go step forward into the breach, and we're all delighted that he's going to be the interim principal for next year, and everybody is on board and enthusiastic about it, and members of the committee that I chaired are all enthusiastic about this outcome.
I'd just like to make a brief comment. I was also on that committee, and it was an interesting learning experience for me as we interviewed several candidates for this position, that over and over again I was struck with the ability and competence of our staff, particularly the high school. And when we looked at who was going to be able to do the job for us, it became very clear that Mr. Lepisto was going to be able to do it. And I was just very much impressed with the staff that's now capable of doing it.
Having been on that committee myself, I enjoyed it. I just want to say a comment. We had a student representative, Sandy Jane Hibby, and I can't imagine what she is going to do in life, but if she shows the same kind of good judgment and sort of insight into people that she showed on that committee, and if that's representative of our students, I think we're in very good shape.
Let me second that, because it leads me to something that Charlie was saying earlier. You serve on the school board, and you see quite often a lot of problems, but you also see some very good things, and Jen Higgins was one of them. But I also served as the advisor to two of the high school students that were in the community service program for 2 weeks. And from these two experiences, I really came away with a very good feeling about the school and the new young people. I congratulate all of them.
And we do welcome our new interim principal and for the work in the and also thank Frank for his many contributions. Moving on, as you said, we do have a fairly long list here. Summary of middle school computer plans. I seem to have succeeded in getting somebody else to talk about all of these various things. I won't do that to you, because we have, in fact, distributed in your packet a summary from Nancy Houghton, principal of the middle school. I know that this is work in progress, because during the budget process, we all looked at what we were doing and realized that the time had come for us to make some significant changes or change in direction with our middle school computer program, as well as looking at our needs throughout the system. This is an example of, as I said, work in progress from a group primarily grades 4 through 8. I think they show real thought and an effort to break through what has been the original curriculum. I like the point that they're making over and over again that our overall goal is to teach students, all students, that a computer is a tool that will help them in most classroom areas. This is, of course, an issue that is difficult for a system to concurrently get enough hardware to use throughout the system, to have enough staff development for teachers to be comfortable and truly on top of things, and, of course, to teach students or to build on what they are teaching themselves. As I observe in many cases, there are people coming into schools with computers at home. Just one other thing I would say is that we've also looked at some issues at the high school, and we're continuing to look at issues in Palm Cove. As we talk about the building project, it does occur to some of us on that committee that we have already seen a need for us to have some consultant help in trying to figure out what kind of vision for the future in computers should we have. Because building a building offers the opportunity to put in wiring as well as certain places for computers. And we're finding that the changes are so rapid that it is not automatic that you put in the computer lab. It's not automatic that you put in a certain kind of wiring and so on. So we're going to be using the upcoming building project. You notice I'm very optimistic about this. And also, as well, continue this kind of review, and I just want to thank that group as well as Nancy for avoiding the time. Any comments?
This is so much fun. I forgot what it was like.
Taking every opportunity.
I had to wait a whole year. library aspect of their computer education, how are they taught this? Is there some kind of formalized program where they visit the library periodically to learn how to use these parts that are all different types of things?
The city administrators have done an issue as part of the library's first program. And it's everything that the library has come down to, like the social studies class and the science class. We probably have not hit every time that we create, however, if they come to use it on the day that we have to be working on this project. And part of the design for next year is that close connection with the library and classroom set up that we have down in the library and that people are using this resource. Our library issue, a lot of our secondary kids get much clearer classes to class and shit sometimes having as much access to the library as we'd like in the future. So that is a real effort of ours. We also are going to perhaps connect with some of the computer lab funds to use that to use the library. In fact, we're using the 8th grade as a joint project in working with the library resources and then using the computer lab to use our project.
So the actual computer lab, change the purpose, they make a change in purpose, but they utilize their, what's happening in the classroom as far as curriculum and their application. How much time do you foresee for teachers in elementary people to be doing their project? Is that still under development?
It's still, all of this is still developing and we try to value it and see it by that university. But my understanding is we're always starting with keyboarding at the first lesson in the fall and work on that and then begin to apply it. I have been under the impression, how about if we just keyboard and master that and then go on to the next area? But teachers tell me that the kids are on board, so they're ready to do that for a while and then apply it using the spreadsheet or using the word processing. But the goal is that by the time students get to the 8th grade, that they will be mastering the keyboard and they should not be issued with the rest of the
year. Thank you, Lisa. Just a note as a follow-up, we had a workshop on total quality a couple of weeks ago, and we had a meeting last week to try to get a representative group from the various work sections in the system. It's a busy time of year, hard to get everybody there. But we had, a good cross-section of people to meet the gentleman who will be spearheading the training. We have another meeting tomorrow, and as a result of that, I will have a memo. I will be able to get a memo out to staff before the end of the school year, indicating what some of the opportunities will be this summer, and making clear that I want to eventually reach out to anybody that's interested. And by the way, love to have students involved. That's going to be an issue that we have to plan for and take care of, and it may not happen overnight, but we'll say more about that later. And again, I just distributed the beginning of the meeting. We had our orientation meeting last night, and
we have the committee appointments for the 1993-94 school year school board committees. The finance subcommittee, Peter Leslie will be the chair, and Craig Beeling and Charles Greer will be members. Policy subcommittee, Rosemary Reed is the chairman, Beth Currier and Mark Foray are members. And then for some of the smaller committees, on the athletic fee committee, the representative will be Mark Foray. Building committee, Ann Chapman and Charles Greer. Co-curricular committee, Peter Leslie. Community coalition, Mark Foray. Diversity committee, Beth Currier. Legislative liaison contact person, Rosemary Reed. Main school board association delegate, Charles Greer. Negotiations are ongoing right now, and we continue with the people who have already started to be appointed. These contracts are up for renewal. PRVTC general advisory board, Rosemary Reed. And total quality steering committee, Ann Chapman and Craig Beeling. And I should note that these committee assignments will take effect as of our next board meeting, which is July 6th.
have a report in your packet from Dan Bose, which I think summarizes very clearly some of the issues that we've dealt with. I do want to share with you some of the succeedings and opportunities. I'll just pass these out. Pictures that I'm distributing are pictures of Susie Terry and fifth graders meeting with a group of students from Reiki. And this was an idea back along when we were talking about cultural diversity, and we were thinking that in fact some of our students in the high school plan to make trips to different countries, partly for foreign language experiences, partly to have direct contact with different cultures. And what happened here is that Susie made contact with a Kate Perry, who is, has an ESL class in Reiki, and it escapes me right now. I think it's 24 different languages spoken by the total of 24 different languages spoken by those students. The pictures show the fifth graders, our fifth graders, who had been involved with weaving in Susie Terrian's class. She does some remarkable art objects through that medium. And they decided that that would be a good way for students to be able to have a direct contact with or without facility in language. And pictures say more than anybody can actually say in summary descriptions. What struck me were the rapt expressions on the kids' faces. They are really looking and communicating. And I think that our kids doing the teaching are getting out of the experience, and I certainly think the youngsters who were being taught are also benefiting out of it. The diversity committee, which we started last year, as your packet summary points out, in sort of in response to an unfortunate incident in what appeared to be a multi-faced situation, I wanted to know better what the dimension of the problem might be. And it's turned out to be a forum that different groups in the community, different groups connected with school, have heard about and have asked to come to meetings and either listen and or express a form view. I would say that the bottom line is that we have discovered some of the things that our new chairman mentioned in his remarks. Concern about a climate of respect. It isn't so much that we think people are necessarily beating up on each other, but we are concerned about the signals that seem to go out. We are, and what really got my attention, frankly, was we had some students come to our meeting who were talking about kind of looking over their shoulders, wondering, are we in, are we out? How, you know, sort of uncomfortable about these day-to-day issues of how well do we treat each other. I could not begin to analyze how much of an issue that is or how what exactly we will do about it, but as the summary points out, we've had some specific ideas and goals, one of which is to review our handbooks for specifics on guidance on behavior, and to reach out to the parent community so that we can be clear about what we see as school people, what the rules ought to be, but ask also for parent input and agreement to the issues and possible consequences. We'd also, of course, like to include students in some of that discussion, too. So I think we have a pretty practical view of what we want to tackle through this committee. That may, in fact, seem, that particular issue may not sound like diversity, but it is absolutely tied to the issue of respect. And we've had a lot of groups speak to us about the fact that don't think that we would need to worry about various aspects of discrimination if we could truly act in a way every day that models respect for each other. So kind of a big topic, and we will start with some specifics in behavior. Pam did in fact comment on a couple of other issues that we'd like to do, and we have made some attempts to review our policies that are pertinent to this, and we will keep on doing that. But I think, and the final thing I would say is that an issue that's come up a number of times in these discussions, when we wrote our mission statement almost 2 years ago, or a year and a half ago, adopted about a year ago, I guess, mission statement says very clearly that the mission of the Cape Elizabeth School Department and the school district is academic, to have an excellent academic program. And some people felt that that left out feelings and attitudes and some kind of issue of respect. We tried to point out that in the value statements that go along with that mission statement, there are very clear statements about the necessity to have the business of schools going on in an atmosphere of respect. And that obviously is what we've talked about a lot in this diversity committee. And I think it's important to understand that there really aren't two separate kinds of education. Education is both cognitive and affective, and it goes on mixed together. You can't expect quality learning to go on in an atmosphere where people are not comfortable, at least comfortable enough to know that they will be able to work in a safe environment. So the safe environment, the comfortable environment, in the sense of respect, is important. But that doesn't mean that it's either or. We would see it as a mission of learning in the context. I think we're going to continue to talk about that issue because I hear it come up in a number of ways in different groups. That's my current attempt to explain it. And that is, I think, one of the things that has come out of our discussion. And don't walk off with pictures. I promise Susie I'll be there. Would you like to circulate? You can circulate the pictures if people would, if anybody would like to see.
Any other comments? Seeing none, we'll move on to school board subcommittees and reports, and I'll yield first to the finance subcommittee chair.
Thank you. This is the last report for the school year ending 1993, although there will be a final report that will be given. By the new finance chair. At the finance committee meeting that was held immediately before the school board meeting tonight, we received the financial statements from the business manager. We viewed the year-end balances, and for the public's information, our total revenues to date are 90.63% of budget, and our expenses are 90.79%. So we're consistently spending and receiving the allocated sums. We signed the school warrants, and we took a long review of the school lunch budget, the lunch program. I discussed with the school lunch director many of the issues that have been going on in the schools throughout the year, including the proposed increase in the hot lunch and milk prices beginning for the next school year, as well as changes in the federal law regarding the types of foods that can be served to our students beginning in September. And
we'll move on to the middle school building committee. Adam?
The middle school, or essentially middle school, school building committee has met three times since our workshop in May. And then on May 27th, June 7th, and June 17th. We will be meeting on the 22nd of June to formalize the conceptual design for a presentation before the board on our July 6th meeting. Preview to the town council presentation on July 12th. Invite all board members to come to the June 22nd meeting. And it really will be a good time to see the final conceptual design. And hopefully they will have some models and some innovations. The floor plan is pretty much in place at the time. Most of the business of the day, a great deal of attention has been given
this point, actually, the meeting, summary meeting is tomorrow, so I don't have much to report except to say that we're doing it. I would want to, however, point out that we've had a couple of meetings since budget time. Dan Reed, our maintenance supervisor, Freddie Willis, who is our ADA coordinator, with input from parents and people on the committee, have drawn up a list of recommendations with our budget in mind. Recall, of course, we put some budget materials in our budget for that purpose. We are using the proposals, and I would expect that they will get approval in our meeting tomorrow, and we should be prepared to go forward with those summer projects as we plan for them.
Okay, we have no unfinished business tonight. We'll move on to new business and personnel requests.
Okay, we'll start with resignations. We have a letter of resignation. I think these are all in the packet. There's three of them tonight. We have Celeste Roberge, who certainly will be very sorry to see leave. She's accepting a teaching position, teaching sculpture at the University of Florida, beginning in August, Great Canyon, Florida. I'm afraid it's a decision she's already made. Anybody who's ever seen Celeste's work or talked to her or seen her with the students just has to say she's one of the finest teachers around. Possible, and we've been very fortunate to have her services, certainly which is very, very well. We also have a lot of resignation from Laura Gibbs, an equally fine, outstanding teacher. She, as you may recall, came to us at the turn, right after Christmas time, asking for an unpaid leave due to a family move. She has now realized that they're not moving back here, and so she has. And the regrets made the decision to leave us. And Janet Nesson, who you may recall, at the beginning of the year, requested a year's leave of absence for personal reasons, decided to let us know that she was planning on coming back. She was abroad, and she has come back, but she is going to be settling in another part of the state, so she also is going to be leaving us. And since we knew in advance of this meeting that she was leaving, and because we wanted to pursue the in a timely fashion filling that position, I am taking the liberty, or I did take the liberty, of going forward with the process, and I have a nomination for the some of those positions. Okay. You want me to go on down through, or you'll need a motion for these things as you go on?
Should we just do it?
Might as well do the motion as you go on, okay? Mm-hmm. So we're...
I would end it.
Madam Chair, I move that we accept the resignation of Janet Nesson, Laura Gibbert, and Celeste Roberge.
Discussion? All in favor?
Thank you. And moving on, as I said, I had. Knowing that these were coming up and anxious to have some closure before the end of the school year, I've gone through our process. And we have nominations for two of the three resignations that you just saw. First off, on the list will be for Schmidt Grade 3, which is a one-year position. Mary Hart for High School Art, and Gordon, popularly known as Skip. None of us call him Gordon, it's a Skip for us. Spanish, and Jamie Moore, who already is in the system as a special education teacher half-time. We're nominating her for sixth grade position, just vacated by Janet Nesson. We do have in the packet summer information. Some of you may have been here. Mary Hart was teaching for us part-time this year. She's of course teaching with us this year. And some of you may have been here when Skip was here a couple of years ago. He left us because all we had at that time was a part-time position. He went to Winslow, where he taught for the last 2 years, and done an outstanding job for them. And we did have a very strong pool of Spanish teachers, and he was the man. So those are
Madam Chair, I move that we accept the nomination of Lisa Schmidt, grade
co-curricular nomination for co-curricular positions, and in case any, I think I mentioned this to the new board members, in case somebody listening is wondering what are co-curriculars, those are student activities that are non-athletic. So nominations for following individuals for co-curricular positions. These happen to be all at the middle school, and they are for team leadership positions. Deborah Cross, grade 5, Steve Conley, grade 6, Joe Fabbitt, grade 7, Joanne Dowd, grade 8, Carolyn West, special education, and Ryan Tracy, foreign language, and Dana Perkins, allied arts.
Madam Chair, I move that we accept the list as read by the superintendent for the middle school team leadership positions for 1992.
This is the proposal.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Now we're down to an item that has been mentioned a couple of times today, and I feel like we ought to have a little music or drum roll or something. You got a band outside?
Bring them in.
Rich is useful. And we're pleased and happy to nominate you as our new principal for 1993 in the first year.
I'm like, I'm real excited about the opportunity and challenge.
I move that we accept the superintendent's nomination of Richard E. Smith as the beautiful principal of the high school.
I don't like the show.
That'll happen now.
I'll second it.
For 1993-94 school year.
Second.
All in favor?
Excellent. Rick, we can cross each other out.
Did you look as a Clinton something maybe you have a hand to do? Give you a hand. I see, I took that out of, I've already done the co-curricular. Ah, that's because I'm in my title. Okay, the next item is a little complicated, and we did have some information in your packet, and some of us have had many conversations since then, and I've sort of lost track of which was the latest sheet. I think, did we just get another one tonight?
Mm-hmm.
This is about enrollment projections. As those of you who have been on the board know, we've been pointing out to you our concern about the growth at the in kindergarten, because where we started, we had a number of, actually, this year we have 8 sections, and in our budget we already have approved an additional section of 9 sections, and now the issue is, do we go with a second or a 10th section, I should say. The information that you have tells you that you had in your packet, but the update, and I'm looking for my update. Too many updates. Here, I got it right here. Sorry. Well, I got the 12 noon. Is there? 12 noon. All right. Okay. I think this is almost the same. The only difference is in the kindergarten. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Then I'll just keep this. Must be another 2. Okay, I got it. Thank you. What we have done finally, because administratively we've had numerous conversations for the last, actually the last 3 weeks, and in some cases going back a semester, trying to watch the comings and goings. And the sheet you have in front of you tells you for grades 1 through 5 where we are, including retentions, June departures, new entrances, trying to come up with what we think is the total right now, taking the number of staff positions that we have, dividing into that total, and telling you what the individual grade size will be. In addition to this information, I should point out that there is one piece of information that we also reviewed, and that is our class size policy. The current policy calls for, and these are recommended sizes, they aren't cast in concrete, but they're just at those numbers and where they are right now and the policy suggested sizes, it was clear when we reviewed the third grade projected 146 that we needed to do something about that because the current policy talks about 20 and the six sections of 146 were yielded as 24. So we looked around for some solutions. The budget, of course, has already been passed. It is unlikely that we would be able to simply add a position at this point. On the other hand, we thought we didn't want really to start the school year with that. So summarizing all of this, what I indicated in your packet is that, and I see we have a number of kindergarten teachers here tonight, probably we'll have something that they would like to share with you. Although the kindergarten right now is just at the recommended size, one of the things that is very hard to predict for kindergarten is how many people are going to be added during the summer. The usual practice or the usual experience in the past has been that people do move in and there is some additional people coming in, and I think that the kindergarten teachers do have some other issues that I want to share with you about the feeling about that, which is why we're bringing it up, should we add that 10%. The other issue is we went back to the third grade and looked at what we should do. First of all, we realized that we had 117 students moving into the fourth grade and 146 moving into the third grade, and as we are set up, we have six divisions in both of those grades. There's an obvious imbalance. Then when you take into consideration the size, the recommended size of individual class divisions, since they're 20 at grade 3 and 22 at grade 4, it seems that if one class is going to have larger classes, according to policy, it makes more sense to have it at grade 4 than at grade 3. Another piece, we did in fact go ahead and look at grade 5, and we also looked at some of the scheduling and staffing implications that would be at grade 5, and even, as a matter of fact, looked at the possibility of the resignation at the sixth grade and see if there was some way in which we could solve all of these problems in going in that direction. For a variety of program complications that occur at the middle school, we thought that was not the best solution. So we'll go back to Pine Cove and try to find our solution to the dilemma of class size for within Pine Cove. The budget has in it a teacher assistant. We have not yet staffed that position. And one of the things that we would do if we go with the recommended fewer number of sections in grade 4, with a 23.4 class size, we would certainly want to continue to fund that teacher assistant to make sure that we have enough teacher assistant time in the building to devote that kind of resource to that grade. The other issue, of course, is how, if we go with the extra kindergarten section, how are we going to fund it? It isn't in the budget. On the other hand, as we get to this time of year, we've begun to have the resignations and the new appointments that some of the teachers went through tonight. At this point, those are yielding extra money in the salary account to the point where I would feel we could cover that decision if you decide to do that. I think that's a summary. If you have questions, I would be trying to find anything. I know this is somewhat confusing. Yes? Mm-hmm. The other issue I need to mention, and I think we also have a chart, Pond Cove is badly strapped for space. And one of the problems that we are realizing as we look at the particulars of our space needs for next year, we have been squeezing special ed, reading recovery, chapter one, into very, very small spaces. And we have a chart which tries to show you how an extra classroom would be used and possible uses of a third classroom. The space issue is not necessarily one you have to consider tonight. That's an administrative issue. I would want to let you know that for a variety of reasons, it's one we will be looking at, and it does put a limit on the number of sections of different things we can put into Pond Cove. want to really focus on that tonight because it's not a staffing issue, but I think it's important as another part of the puzzle to realize that we have to look at that as part of our decision-making process. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer those, or have somebody in administration or state answer.
Grade 5.
Yeah.
I'm not sure which is going to be the newspaper on that, but let's assume that it's now going to be 130.
Yeah.
Grade 5.
Mm-hmm. That's what I
Well, you could, instead of having 7 teachers, have 6 and still be spot on, year 22, which is the norm.
So who will be staffing it? It's only that school. She is a school teacher. She's our school teacher. So what happens if her class is just a school?
So really it looks like the fifth grade is going to stay at about 18 per class.
Seems there's a substantial statistical bump by that grade 4. And these questions, I understand the motivation for an accelerated math program in the fifth grade program, but this may have to be, I fail to see a lot of distinction between some students in the third or fourth grade, and I don't know if, if this has been given some consideration. Obviously, third and second grade are down a bit, but fourth grade, there is quite a bump. Is this situation in the fifth grade that only this teacher, if they moved a section down, this accelerated math program would be gone? Is that what I'm hearing? Does it have to be that person?
I think the question that he's asking is if it is a seniority or what, if that would be considered a
talking about adding a teacher in fourth grade to 6th.
I'm sorry, I'm trying to do it.
To fourth grade, are we talking about adding a teacher so we have a total of 6?
No, the if you look at the chart you have, the column on the right hand side is telling you what would happen if we move that, make that move at fourth grade. In other words, what you have here, keeping in mind the board, projected sizes and so forth. What is really driving the problem at the upper grade level, or the third, fourth, and the fifth grade level. Third grade happens to be in rooms that are pretty small, too. The fourth grade is in our most generous size rooms as far as that goes. So that's another consideration. But the fourth grade with a board policy recommended size of 20 had crept up to 24. So you had a gap there, 4 kids rather than 1 or 2. this solution gives you a fourth grade of 23, which is 23 to some, possibly a 24, and again, we don't know exactly where it will finally be. Not ideal. On the other hand, certainly not unacceptable, and a grade number that, in fact, third grade had last year. So it's something that third grade has had, has frankly had each year, that kind of a problem. The fifth grade, we certainly looked at that and considered the things that you're pointing out. I do think I should point out that solutions to this kind of thing are best sought within the particular building for scheduling purposes. There are all kinds of duty issues. There are all kinds of things that trying to move staff around, even for 1 year and so on, gets to be difficult. What we need to do is take a good hard look at this in the budget process and look at the people we have and make some of those decisions earlier. It's very hard to move people out of where they are and the plans that have already been made programmatically, as for instance an accelerated math class, at this time of year. So we've tried to balance out both a concern for everybody involved, but also program and budget issues. In fact, the assignment of the accelerated math class to one of our regular fifth grade teachers was made at budget time because we cut out the piece of the budget, if you recall. Eleanor Redman was teaching that as a separate class and a separate budget item. And we simply deducted that from our budget. And instead, we would assign that to a teacher. The decision was made then that this was a teacher that was best suited for that. So now, as we go back and look at it, it's just awkward for us to make a change at this time.
That's fine. I understand that. I would sort of think asking the question from the point of view of being questioned sometime in the future by somebody who says, well, how come you're 18 in the fifth grade?
I understand.
How come you're 23 in the fourth grade?
I understand.
And, I just felt I had to understand it a little bit.
Well, we've gone over this with a fine-tooth comb, and I can absolutely appreciate that, and I think that we will certainly drive a lot of discussions at budget time, but we also are concerned that we not push the pieces around too much at this point.
Your proposal at this time is the same as the teacher.
Absolutely. I would. That's correct. I would not.
How does this impact the teacher assistants in your six-day schedule? Okay, your proposal for your proposal for the addition of a teacher assistant is you've broken it down in what areas they will teach academics. Social studies, current events for fourth grade. That was what they were saying with the current staffing in the classroom. Do you see a need for that? Assistance from A to fourth grade, or I guess I'm concerned about the fourth grade maybe a little more assistance because their class size is definitely larger than everybody else.
Especially in light of the boys. I was just wondering if there's any way you can say if this is the fourth grade
personally, I don't see any reason at all. That would be my understanding. It's a quid pro quo.
Just to be clear, though, not everybody was team five.
Four of us.
And also, I think that the reading writing issue is obviously more than that, just a fourth grade problem.
I just feel that if you increase the class size of the middle school, position is similar, but you give them much more support than they can. And that's the only way that I would do it. Because I have a computer, and when I see the numbers of 18 in the fifth grade class, the class size is going to be 24 in the fourth grade.
I would agree.
I have to look at everything from a system-wide approach. That's all the difference. I understand that the limit that they're in, the person has the least seniority, the limit can only at this point keep themselves broken. In the future, we really need to look at this limit. We need to approach and solve it from a system approach.
I would agree with Charlie, particularly since my understanding is third grade had this kind of numbers, we talked about the same kids. Having that kind of class size is quite a difference between 20 and 24 kids.
Well, just to be clear, though, the grade three, the guidelines are 20, and grade four, the 22.
My understanding from the comments tonight, though, was that the grade three teachers this year had to deal with larger class sizes, so we're talking about the same kids coming in here.
Last year. Actually, the grade going to grade five is going to be taking on classes in grade three.
Okay.
Actually, the ones who perhaps would still be with smaller class sizes.
That makes sense.
Any other comments? Did any of the kindergarten?
We're concerned about the class sizes. Concerned about the class sizes, but we are in relation to how many teachers we currently have working. For a number of reasons, it's at 18.5 now, and that's with 9 sessions. Historically, there's been more kids who come in August, and Connie mentioned that. But we're concerned for a number of other reasons as well. This year, in order to better prepare for placement this year, because we're in a unique position where we don't have the information of having the children already through the school for a year. The children that come in, we've historically been placing them with very little data about behavior, about academic functioning, about all those different kinds of issues. So in order to do a better job this year, so we can build better classes, got some more information. We sent out a parent questionnaire asking about learning styles and their child's current educational experiences. We sent a questionnaire to the child's teacher with the parent's permission, all the preschools and nursery schools in the area, to find out similar information. Then we also made site visits to the child's nursery schools so we could see them on their own turf and how they function in the classroom. We also expanded our screening process to include the Brigantz kindergarten screening. That's a little bit different information than the current one that we use in the current day. That's used in the current kindergarten screening. So we were able to get a lot more data about the individual students. And the makeup of the incoming group has some specific needs. You can refer to the based on the information that we collected, about 12% of our incoming students were deemed at risk academically. And that was based on the parking and the GANs tests and how they performed on that piece. 16% are unwatched for behavior issues. That was, we got that information from the questionnaires from the parents and the nursing schools, and also from the survey of the children on the site. And 9% were observed to be developmentally young. So we've got about 37% of the incoming kindergarten students may need some additional specific programming and monitoring. In a class like you had this year, where the numbers are a little bit low, you wouldn't be quite so concerned. But we feel like it's our responsibility to tell you what we see coming in, so that can give you a little bit more information about when you make the decision about class sizes. There are a little bit concerned about that, in combination with the large numbers and also the kind of class that we're getting. We want to be able to provide exceptional programming. We've been working for 2 years to really change some of the stuff that we're doing and make it a maybe more challenging program. We want to continue to be able to do that. Just supports those points.
Could you please tell me the, I don't know much about parking, like the term high school, it's here. Could you tell me what the current thinking is of sending 9% or 16 students to kindergarten when they're doing the developmental year?
16
students. 9%.
Wow. That's what those figures are.
Why are they coming to kindergarten if they're being developmentally young?
Well, the current feeling of the community is that learners are accepted into the environment by the appropriate chronological age. So we get a mixture of many different age groups in our classrooms. That's another reason why we're concerned at keeping class sizes manageable. We're up to that challenge, but that's the current, developmentally young has nothing really to do with chronological age.
So everyone who enters our kindergarten is age 5 biological.
That's the law.
Right, I mean, I'm just concerned.
I guess that would be my answer, it's the law.
I mean, I've had people call me who said my child was born on October 16th at 1 o'clock in the morning. And I said, fine, go call Augusta and see what kind of answer you get from them. And they say, absolutely, midnight at 5. And so that's not an issue we have any control over.
Well,
I'm glad because it's one of
the
decisions I'm going to make.
Right.
I think it's really important to know for the, it was all part of the discussion of the campaign. The phrase that sticks in my mind is the community made the decision, the board made the decision.
Thank you.
couple of questions and comments. The 37% of incoming kindergarten students who require some additional specific, it seems to be an addition of the three percentages. Can a lot of those kids be doubled? I mean, a lot of the ones that are developmentally young are probably the ones that might have behavior problems and be at risk academically. So we may not be talking about 37%.
Check that data. These are cross-correlated.
They are cross-correlated. Second question is, about how many additional kindergarten enrollments do we get over the summer? Do we have any idea if it's 5, 10, you know, any history of what those numbers look like that would be added on to this 1, 6, 3, 7? Over the summer. Yeah, I mean, I guess my feeling would be that, you know, looking at the class size of 18.5, if we could know that it was a frozen figure, I would be comfortable going with the 9 sections, looking at what we're doing for fourth grade and trying to justify in the system. But if there's a good indication that we would add 10 to 20 students over the summer, I don't think any of us would want to then keep it at 9 and would want to jump to 10. I understand your reasoning of it would be helpful to know and make that decision now, but we don't want to do it too premature. And the other comment I guess I'd like to make is I probably have a child that would have been categorized as last year in nursery school if he had been observed as probably at risk for behavior issues and then developmentally young. And I'll tell you, one summer makes all the difference in a lot of these kids' lives, especially, I think, at that level and making a change into a big school. Seems to have survived, as Ted will know. And the other thing that I think we should remember is we do use a lot of volunteers in the kindergarten, probably the best place we do use them. And if we could, you know, the 18.5 figure, if we even use more volunteers, would probably be fine. It's just, I think, looking at if we have 10 to 20 more coming in.
That's a good point. But I want to talk a little bit about some data that we also see this year. The current levels of children in the classroom, using those parent volunteers and some of the other programs, I think this year we were able to do some exceptionally good work, particularly on the language arts area. Class sizes at the size that they are now, we're able to send, I think, 36 or 38% of our children to first grade convention meetings. I think that saves a lot of money down the line when you talk about special ed money and other issues like that. I think that's worth taking a look at. I personally feel that the class sizes that Deborah was talking about, 15, 16, when you're talking about of a wide range of learners in the classroom, especially when the children are young, it makes sense to have those numbers. I'd ask you that you consider that data when you make a decision. One more piece. We've worked hard to develop a team that focuses on quality issues, and it works together as a group. And it is difficult to, it's not difficult, it's better to have someone on board earlier so that they can be trained. Excellent candidate, it's better to have someone on board earlier in the year. Also, I think you can get a better candidate in June than you might be able to get in August, just because you get hired. So I just ask you to consider those facts.
Do you have any guess or knowledge of what percentage of kids were sent to the grade convention meeting compared to the year?
Yes, because we just started collecting the data this year, but I would,
as far as the profile of this class, is this unusual, do you think?
Yeah. Beth's point is well taken. I would disagree with her. First of all, we're talking about a specific individual. But this is unusual in my experience as a first grade and a kindergarten teacher. 12 years I've been teaching this. It's highly unusual, this particular thing. Concerning. Much more than this year's class or us.
Why specifically?
Because of the amount of children who we screened that seem to need different pieces, different extra pieces, or different plans
would just point out in the letter, it says the limit of 18, there's not a limit, so.
I understand that.
It is a guideline, and, I guess I feel a little bit, it's difficult to make a decision, you know, with this 37% on the basis of, you know, talking about one year. I don't think we have enough data to know if many classes would look like that, if you looked at everything with the same testing, the same questionnaires and all that kind of thing. So I'm uncomfortable, you know, on the face of it, just saying that this class, you know, to deal with the school and everything. I think the class that's in kindergarten now is a special case where there's some particular, real identified things. These, to me, seem somewhat more nebulous and more like what we could expect to get, you know, coming in.
Well, I understand how you feel that way based on the data, but our responsibility is based on our experience and our collective experience that this is unusual and this is somewhat extraordinary based on what we've seen. I can understand that it might not be the hardest data that we'd all like to see, but I think that's what our general feeling is and the reason why we would all come down here on the next working on. On a Tuesday night and really speak to you. We appreciate the opportunity. Volunteers are identified through at the open house and sometimes before. Parents who would like to work with guided reading and guided writing programs. Once they're identified, there's a 3-hour training session that the kindergarten team works with parents and takes them through a series of exercises that enlightens them in how children at this particular stage of reading development learn to read. Like them to do with the children. Basically, parents work one-on-one with the children. The commitment is between an hour and an hour and a half per week for the parent, usually on 3 days a week. At that time, the parents come and work on the reading couch or the reading table and the writing table with the children. Teachers draw individualized plans for each child, and the parent follows through with those plans. Then they write a response to how the child did and what their on whatever plan that we provide for them. Then we write a new plan based on what the parent has written. That's in addition to what the teachers do individually with the students in the reading program. That's extra with the parents. At the writing table, it's very similar. We have a journal process where children write in a blank book. They draw pictures and they write. Make a plan, then follow through with the drawing of the plan, and then write a sentence or two sentences or three sentences based on the picture, matching the pictures of the parent. And then the parent will again follow through with the teacher made plan depending on the needs of that individual child.
The number of students that are serviced by the
between 4 to 5 a day. Flexible based on the needs of the child. It starts off every child reads on a rotating basis. Towards the end of the year, or towards the middle of the year, when it seems necessary, teachers may have the parent work for a particular child. Generally, I think the teacher themselves will step in.
Total number is up to 38%. Are there more students in the service by this program?
The entire kindergarten population is serviced. The
was just going to say, the program is a wonderful program. I am in the classroom, in the kindergarten classroom, one day a week, and see what goes on. My hope would be, if we did have to go with larger class sizes, that we would try to have two guided readers at a time, parents doing that, so we could get around to all of the kids to read as much as possible. Because the kids only read, they have specials on certain days too, so they're only, I think, 3 days a week that they actually can be read with or written with. And I mean, you have to sort of remember that, and even though they're in school 5 days, they're only 3 days to do that. And I think the program really has helped these children learn to read in kindergarten. It's been great.
In some ways, I'm kind of a veteran at this now, even though I only have 6 years in Cape Elizabeth, and I was happened back by Peter's comment about a lengthy board discussion several years ago relative to case load or class load in kindergarten, and a fairly notable shift from that whole pre-K, K, K-1, transitional one model, which charged the kindergarten staff to take children where they were and take them where they could go. And I think they've done that, and I've watched them over the years now pull together a very excellent program for children. And I think in terms of my first year here, there was a fourth grade class that was the fourth grade class that was introduced to me, so that way, as children who, when they were in kindergarten and first grade, sounded very much like the profile Ted just described. And those children, by the time we got to the fourth grade class, were the topic of two major board discussions. And I can remember in Loretta's first bits of interaction as a board member was her saying, we need to support these children with what they need. And this year, you heard during the budget process from some of the parents of those kids who are now freshmen and still struggling with reading. The point I want to make here is the foundation of what happens is so significant. I want to give you another class profile, second grade next year. The current first grade has a very low number of children who will be receiving, comparatively speaking, other grades, who will be receiving special education services. I can't prove it, and I'm going to stick my head out there, but it's in speculation. I think the reading recovery program will play an impact on that. And that's a foundational program. And if I had my own way, I guess K-1 would be the place where I'd have the greatest concern about attention to individual children and the impact over the long run of years in terms of budget, additional staff, more difficult behaviors to deal with, risk to disrupt other children, the kinds of things you've heard tonight are very relevant from my perspective over time, looking at two class profiles here. And I just wanted to share that with you. I'm not necessarily promoting something, but that's what is that I've lived through since I came here, and it dawned on me that those two groups of kids are very different from the current programs.
I'm glad you said that, Mike, because I'm just sitting here listening to some of the comments that were being made, and bit by bit, in spite of the fact that I was in Tampa, Florida at 3 o'clock this morning on board a trip, I was beginning to recollect some of the bait we had that 5 or 6 years ago, and it's scary to realize that I am now the longest serving member of the school board. I hope we're not going to forget the turmoil and trouble that we did have 5 or 6 years ago, and it was really, thinking back on it, it was just before I went on the board that it started. It was probably one of the most difficult academic subjects that we dealt with, and I think we put it right. I think the board put it right then, mostly before I got on it, as I recall. But I think we ought to stick with that, getting the school ready for the kids. And I think it's essential that the small class size be maintained to the extent we can within our budget.
I'd like to just make one comment on what Wayne said. I think a very significant point he made was that this is foundationally, you're starting out the kids' first experience in school, not just academically, but socially and in every other manner. Has a big impact from that point on. You hear it from everything else, Head Start programs, not obviously in this community, but other communities, but starting out on the right foot, this is where you get to the kids.
I haven't got a clear answer to that. I do think, as far as going back to what you said about reading recovery, we certainly are looking at that. This is, however, I want to emphasize, as I said at the beginning, we're talking about half a teacher here. Excuse me, I didn't take a newspaper, but half a position, which is affordable given the budgetary situation we are in. I think I made that statement originally, and I want to emphasize it. Even though we have other problems in other parts of the budget, we managed to solve those, we hope, relatively equitably without taking the responsibility of having to have to decision. But we certainly don't have enough flexibility in any way, and I think you see it close to town. What full-time teachers, what's the reading recovery, unfortunately, also requires some lines for training, and also requires the reduced class load in the future, and the startup cost of reading recovery, which we've been doing because he's really impressed with the program. But we're not talking about that in the next half. That wasn't part of our budget discussion. There's no possibility of doing it. This is fine.